There was a couple of really good questions and comments on airbrushing with Candy2o, and I always wonder when I reply to those comments and questions if my explanation is making sense, if it's getting across. So I thought it might be a good idea to clarify a couple of things with a question and answer video. So the first question and comment comes from Guy, and I apologize in advance if I get your last name pronounced wrong. It's Guy Verney. He wrote, "Awesome work, mate. As a newcomer to airbrushing, I found it extremely instructional. In part one, you mentioned that the candies were not UV stable. As an automotive painter, I tend to use solvent-based paints as I have access to them. Would a 2K clear coat not seal the candy and stabilize it? I have so many questions, I don't know where to start, so I hope you upload more tutorials which might cover some of them. Once again, great work." First of all, thank you, Guy. I appreciate the kind words. That's what motivates me to keep making more of these videos. As far as your other questions, please, guys, if you have questions, something you want to see, something you want to learn, leave them in the comments for me. I have so many ideas and plans in my head for future videos that I want to make, but whether or not I cover a specific question or an issue that you want to see is going to be kind of hit and miss if I don't know what your questions are. If you leave me your questions in the comments, then I can guarantee you at some point I will cover those questions in a video. So back to your question. The answer is yes. If you use an automotive urethane or a 2K clear coat over the top of your candy, you will stabilize the candy to an extent. But the reality is the aniline dyes cannot hold up to constant UV rays from the sun. It's going to fade at some point. And again, my background is primarily in automotive as well. I used solvent-based for many, many, many years. And I still do some automotive work now. So a lot of the things that I still do still gets a urethane clear coat in the end. A good 2K clear coat has UV inhibitors in it. But again, the aniline dyes in the candies just, they're going to fade. The benefit is, it's not a rapid fade. It's a very slow, progressive thing. I liken it to if you have a family member or a friend that you've known for years and years and years, you see almost on a daily basis, you don't really realize the age progression in a lot of years in people that you see all the time. But if you take a photograph from 20 years ago and compare it with what the person looks like today, then you really see the difference. The same thing goes for the candies. It takes a long, long time. I once did a true fire job on a red truck. There's a lot of oranges and yellows, and I used a lot of candies in it. And that's why we like the candies. The candies really intensify those colors underneath so that when that true fire flame job is outside under the sun, it really makes it glow. And for the first 4 or 5 years, it looked awesome. But after that, it started slowly. The candy started slowly fading away, and it still looked okay as far as the artwork was concerned, but it didn't have the glow and the pop that it did for the first 4 or 5 years when it was finished. And you can take steps knowing that information that the candy will fade. You can use that to maybe change the way you approach a job. For instance, if you've seen my Banshee airbrush portrait video, I used candy in the eyeballs of that portrait. But before I put the candy in, I put a scarlet red layer in. And then I went in and airbrushed some highlights, I went in and erased some highlights out of the scarlet red, and then I went over all of that with a blood red Candy2o. And that was kind of a test bed for me because I painted that on my own Jeep. It's my daily driver. It sees UV rays from the sun all the time. Anybody that knows me knows I'm an avid off-road enthusiast, so it sees a lot more harsh conditions than just the sun. But my thought was, if I start to see that fade in from the blood red Candy2o, then I still have the scarlet color underneath, so I'll still have red in the eyeballs. At this point, it's been about 3 years since I painted that, and I can't tell that it's faded at all at this point. So again, I'm still trying to figure out exactly how long and what the progression is going to be with the Candy2o's fading. The panel we did in part one of airbrushing with Candy2o is still sitting in the window soaking up UV light, just so I can see. But I expect it's going to take a good 5 or 6 years before I really start to see any fading, and then we'll see how it progresses after that. The next question comes from Adam A. Adam wrote, great vid. You recommended SprayMax degreaser for overspray. What do you recommend for testing wet or cleared look before clear coat? I haven't had any real good success with any product. I want to be able to soak my work with something like they do on solvent-based paints to see what a cleared product will look like before clearing. It's an excellent question, and an old trick that custom painters used to simulate a clear coat before we actually put the clear on, so that we can see if there's any adjustments or changes that we want to make, or just to see what it's going to look like with the clear on it. That's especially important sometimes with water-based applications, because the water-based paint dries so flat that if you're using a metallic or a pearlescent or iridescent, any of those cool-looking colors, they dry so flat that you really can't see any of those effects until you put a clear coat over it. So there's a couple ways you can do this. For one, I recommended in Candy2o Part 2 that you don't hose down your artwork with a wax and grease remover. That's specifically because if you do it too soon, there's a pretty good chance you're going to remove paint or you're going to smear your paint. You can hose down your artwork with a wax and grease remover to simulate a clear coat as long as you allow the paint to fully cure first. That length of time will depend on where you're at, the environment, the conditions that you're painting in. I would recommend generally at least 24 to 48 hours. That will give the paint plenty of time to cure. You might remember this panel. I painted this about a month ago, so I know that it is cured. So, using the SprayMax wax and grease remover, I can hose this panel down, and that gives me a decent enough indication of what the artwork is going to look like with a clear coat on it. I'm not sure if the camera will pick this up from where it's looking at it, but that is one option. I wouldn't recommend that you leave the wax and grease remover on the panel for a long period of time. Get a look at it, and then you want to wipe it off. You can see by looking at the paper towel, I'm not removing any paint with the SprayMax wax and grease remover. And again, the SprayMax is designed for water-based applications, and that's one option. Now, just to show you the difference, I can come in with a solvent-based wax and grease remover made for solvent-based systems, the PPG DX330. Because this paint is fully cured, it shouldn't have any effect. It may remove some paint, but it's not going to be a dramatic amount. And again, I'm not sure if the camera picks this up or not, but you get a pretty good indication of what it's going to look like with a clear coat applied. Now, again, don't recommend leaving the wax and grease remover on here for a long period of time. And you can see right there that the PPG DX 330 is actually removing a little bit of paint. And this was just a test panel that I did for another video, so I'm not terribly concerned. And it's not like it's removing a ton of paint, but it is removing some of the paint. So there may be some areas that you want to come in and touch up before you put the clear coat on it. But the DX 330 gives you a better representation because you can put more onto the surface. So you get a better look at what it would look like with a clear coat on it. So what if you don't have the 24 to 48 hours or however long you need to allow your water-based paint to fully cure before you can hose it down with a wax and grease remover to get an indication of what the clear will look like on top of your artwork, whether it's a tight deadline or something to that effect? There is another option. You can go to a solvent-based intercoat clear. I prefer House of Color. You can use any solvent-based intercoat clear that you like. The solvent-based intercoat clear will not affect the Createx products. It will actually protect your artwork. So if you put one or two coats of a solvent-based urethane intercoat clear over your artwork, then you can come over it with wax and grease remover, whether it's solvent-based or water-based, like the KC20 with House of Color, or you can even use deionized water to hose it down and get a really good indication of what it's going to look like cleared. So there's another tip for you. The last comment I wanted to touch on comes from Richard Moore. And Richard wrote, "Great video, mate. Thanks for sharing. I really like the technique of using all candies to build up the layers rather than just using the candy as a uniform glaze. I know you covered this in part one, but worth mentioning that the problem with Candy2o is that once you go too dark with it, you can't lighten it back up. You can erase small areas, but if you want to lighten a large area, you need to go over it with a pigment-based paint, such as Wicked Detail or Illustration, and the Candy2o will bleed through it like a pig unless you seal it with 40-40 bleed checker first. Don't ask me how I know that, LOL." You're correct, Richard. Once you go too dark with a candy, a true aniline dye-based candy, it's nearly impossible to lighten it back up. I'm a huge advocate of having my students try and repair mistakes when they occur. Even if they fail, they're still learning something in the future, so that if that mistake happens again later, they'll know, okay, what I tried last time didn't work, I should try something else. However, when it comes to working with candies, especially what we did in part two of Airbrushing with Candy2o, where the entire artwork is comprised of nothing but candies, it's really impossible. If you make a huge mistake, it's pretty much impossible to go in and correct that. And by going in, especially in a large area with a pigment-based paint to try and lighten something back up, it's a recipe for frustration and disaster. So I don't recommend trying to do that. You have a little bit more leeway in what we did with part one because we had pigment-based paints underneath the candy, but it's still a very difficult thing to accomplish and be successful at it. So I don't recommend trying to repair candies, especially with pigment-based paints. The great thing about candies, in my opinion, especially the water-based candies and the water-based paint in general, is because you have to work in light layers to avoid the pigment migration issues, it really slows you down, which makes it a lot more difficult to go too dark too fast. Now remember that contrast is relative. So going lighter first, once you get the surrounding colors in, then if you need to go in and darken something up, you can always do that later. So always err on the side of caution. So I hope that this has answered these questions a little bit more thoroughly. I find that if one person has a question, then more than likely, there's more than just that person that has the same question. So again, guys, leave your questions and comments below. If you have something that you want to see, something you want to learn, questions, whatever, leave them in the comments. Like I said, if I know what your questions are, then I can guarantee you I can address those in videos in the future. If I don't, then it's going to be hit and miss. So hopefully you've got something out of this. Remember to like, subscribe, and share, and I'll see you guys next time.